Remember the exact moment when I heard about the hate crime murder of Vincent Chin. I just graduated from college. I just gotten a good job teaching in the Los Angeles Community College District. I just gotten married to this man over here. And I felt that I had the whole world's opportunities awaiting me. And then I heard about the horrible hate crime murder of Vincent Chin. I read about how he was in a club celebrating his impending wedding, how two white auto workers, Ronald Evans and Michael Nitz, started yelling at him that it's because of you that we're out of work.
Japanese imports up, American car production down. Layoffs, welfare lines, desperation, and resentment. In some places, union-sponsored trash a Toyota party. Striking out at a symbol of the problem.
I was horrified to learn how they followed him out, grabbed him, and held him down as they hit him with a baseball bat until Vincent's skull cracked, and how Vincent's last words were, "It's not fair," before he slipped into a coma and died.
I was with him for everything he's known. From there and see him, just sit next to him. But he was unconscious. So, then we pull the plug.
But I was just stunned beyond imagination when I learned that the judge let off his murderers with a fine of $3,000 and 3 years of probation.
The victim lingered for 4 days, which again, based upon everything, was indicative to me that they attempted to administer a punishment. They did this too severely in careless, reckless disregard of human life, which is what manslaughter is. And that's what they were found guilty of, and that's what I predicated my sentence on. Had it been a brutal murder, of course these fellows would be in jail now.
It sent a clear message to me that this judge felt that the life of an Asian American was worthless, no more valuable than if Vincent were a dog. I felt more vulnerable than I ever had before. Vincent Chin was just like any of us Asian Americans, In fact, he was like me. He had just started a good job as an industrial draftsman. He was a person that was just about to get married with 400 guests ready to come to his wedding. He was 27 years old, thinking himself that the world's opportunities were waiting for him.
I lost my son. I lost everything. I still, he is my own son. I lost him. I lost my daughter, my future daughter-in-law. I lost everything, and I lost my life. My son is a good boy.
My family arrived in February 4th, 1980 as refugees in Michigan. We had hardly any money. Growing up with so few Asians, the way you are treated by other students and friends, you know that you are naturally different. It was difficult growing up. There were moments when I wish I wasn't Asian. I was called chink and gook, and I remember times when there were kids on the neighborhood street who were not nice. And my family did face, you know, a lot of discrimination. I was born in Chicago, spent the first 4 years of my life there until we moved to Detroit, outside of Detroit, Michigan, about 30 minutes east of Detroit in a town called Sterling Heights, and that we jokingly called Sterling Whites while we were growing up. We were asked, you know, where we were from, what kind of Indian we were. We were called all kinds of names, from wetback to camel jockey to the N-word, because people just didn't know who we were.
I was born in Seoul, Korea. I was one of those infants that didn't have any information. I was put into a baby home and then later a foster care home. And right around 6-9 months, I came to the States. Because my family was not Asian American, they sided more with the Evans family. They were more of the disgruntled, armchair, adamant family. Like, oh, he got what he deserved. He should have met the bar.
The Asian community was actually pretty small in Detroit. And there was an area called New Chinatown, which my great-grandfather opened up a restaurant there in 1940. It was the center of Chinatown. A lot of people would just swing by because you could always run into people there. We were famous for our egg rolls. I do remember when the incident occurred because, again, it's a small community. Word travels fast. I vaguely remember being in the back of our parents' restaurant and someone coming in and saying that Vincent had just been attacked.
It was a black and white photo of an Asian man, and you never saw Asian people in Detroit Free Press, let alone young, and let alone American. And I was so excited. But then as I read it, you know, I was really saddened that, you know, he had been killed.
The only thing that I remember was actually seeing the wedding invitation on the kitchen counter and thinking, well, I guess we don't have to go to this event anymore. And when you're a little kid, you don't really think much about that kind of stuff. Probably when I first realized that this place was bigger than our community was in school, where the teachers, a couple of them, accidentally started calling me Vincent. So at that point, I got really annoyed, and I was thinking, wow, you know, other people are actually hearing. So at that point, it kicked in my head that this was a news story that was beyond our community.
When I heard about the Vincent Chin case, suddenly I realized that there was a link between being called chink and jap and gook on the one hand, and being beaten to death with a baseball bat on the other hand.
The killing didn't attract much attention outside the Detroit area. Then a summons was handed down last month, and now Bernard Goldberg explains why there is an explosion of outrage and sense of betrayal.
That sentence, the fact that no one was sent to prison for even one day, that has so many people outraged and charging that the